Wes Fryer here with Amy Sanders, continuing our discussion about Arab Spring. And the question is, for the project that you're about to do, who's involved in terms of numbers and places, and what are teachers and students in the Arab Spring project going to be doing?
So students will be choosing a country that they're interested in studying. It may be one of six countries that we've identified that were involved in the protest movement: Tunisia, Libya, Egypt, Bahrain, Syria, or Yemen. And they will be put into teams with students from other schools that are interested in studying those countries as well. And then students will have an opportunity to create a small, short multimedia piece to introduce themselves to one another. That will be the first phase of the project. Second is students will then begin to engage in some research to learn more about what the government was like before the protest movements, why protesters are demonstrating for change, how has the government responded, how has the international community responded, and they'll be posting their work into a private blog. And once that research is complete, then it will be posted to a public blog, and we will invite comments from others in the United States and hopefully from the Arab world as well. And then students will have a chance to reflect on what they've learned, read each other's work, and then think about their own experiences with democracy and what they have learned from their research.
I'm going to ask you about student learning and the hope that you have for what students and teachers will learn, but I'm going to ask you personally, how has your understanding of the Middle East been broadened as a result of your travels in Egypt, and what kinds of perceptions are you bringing to this project that might be different from, let's say, the typical, you know, U.S. teacher out there that hasn't studied the area and traveled to the area?
I think my trip to Egypt last year gave me an opportunity to talk with many of the people that we met on a daily basis, talked with us about their experiences. The revolution was only 2 months old at that point, and had a lot of direct experiences, including many of the students that we met, talked to us about their actions during the protest movement. And I was just really inspired by their courage and their desire to learn more about democracy. And I really hope that our students will be able to learn from the experiences of people in the region in terms of their hopes and aspirations for their futures.
So we've talked about public commenting, and that'll be moderated, and we're going to have the web address on our site. It's arabspring.wikispaces.com for people to get more information. How do you think this kind of interaction and this kind of study is going to be different than, you know, students doing a typical country study? We have lots of poster projects that happen in schools, lots of country reports, PowerPoints, things like that. What's your hope and expectation for student learning in the way that this is being set up, especially as far as having opportunities for people in the Arab world to interact?
Well, I think it'll be very interesting for them to have a chance to do this research collaboratively with other students in the United States. But I think one essential difference from the typical sort of project that they do, and they're the consumers of that research, is that they will be able to share it with others. They'll have a chance to hear feedback from people in the region that have experienced these protests. They will be able to comment on student work, add their own experiences, and I think that will just make this a much richer experience for our students to be able to hear directly from those that were involved in the protests.
Great. This has been part two of our video, and we'd encourage you to check out part three, where we'll talk a little bit more about the public commenting and participation.